In essence, but what he went through from day one, from being exiled from being in prison, from being treated in a racist way. He went through tough times, but these tough times and these struggles, he took them into advantage and they made him become stronger. Then you find those people who look at struggles as obstacles. They look at hardship as an obstacle. They see that as soon as I'm in a position where, you know, something's in my way, instead of being strong and being able to fight it, I become weak and I fail. As a first impression, you'd look and you'd be like, okay, the most one out of these three categories, the person that's more vulnerable to depression is the one that looks at struggle as an obstacle. Whereas in reality, if you were to look in a wider scope, every single one of these people is vulnerable to failure. Every single one of these people is vulnerable to falling into depression. Why? The first step of depression thrives off low self-esteem, despair, and sadness. When someone looks and he says, oh, I have goals, but I'm not able to achieve my goals. I'm not able to reach the capabilities and capacity that I want to reach. It feels like, okay, I'm at a point where I'm weak. And that weakness of his causes low self-esteem, causes inconfidence, so he stops. So he doesn't achieve his goals. That is the first step of depression. But if you look a little closer, at each of these categories we just mentioned, and I'm going to repeat the categories in case someone forgot. One, the person who wants to achieve his goals but has no struggles whatsoever throughout his life. Two, the one that also wants to achieve his goals but has struggles throughout his life, but looks at these struggles as if they're stepping stones and ways to build himself. Or three, the person who does have struggles and does have goals, but he looks at the struggles as obstacles. Those are the three points. Look at the person that's lived into a rich family, for example. Okay? You look at him, this guy's living life, he's happy, and whatnot. This guy has goals, he's out to set and accomplish his goals, he's there. Then you look at the second person. The person who wants to achieve his goals, but at the same time is going through very big struggles. And at the same time, he looks at these struggles and be like, oh, okay, these struggles, they're gonna make me become stronger. For example, a couple of months ago, there was a boxing fight, probably every single one of us heard of it. The McGregor and Mayweather fight, probably all of us heard of it. These two competitors, they struggled in their life, and they both had goals. One wanted to become the best boxer of the world, one wanted to become the best MMA fighter of the world. They both had goals, and they both went through struggles, and they both achieved their goals, but they still wanted more. They weren't content. One comes out of retirement, and another goes into a league where he's got nothing to do with it. Mayweather, 41-year-old man, he's completely out of boxing, he's finished, he's retired, he says, I don't want to box anymore. And then Mayweather, which is an MMA fighter, Mahasub of boxing, said, oh, I'm going to box now. You put him into the ring, what caused them to get into the ring together?
Money.
One reason, money. If you look at facts, the only reason they entered the ring together, and they even say it themselves, they actually claimed in a few conferences, is money. Why do I get this example? Because these two, although they had goals, and although they went through struggles and hardships, and although they looked at these struggles and hardships as stepping stones, they were still not content. They still wanted more. They still wanted more money. And I'm not talking about cheap people, brothers and sisters. I'm talking about multi-millionaires, if not multi-billionaires, and they still wanted more. You look at a person like Heath Ledger, for example, an actor that passed away a couple of years ago, who was known for one of the biggest movies you probably all watched as well, The Dark Knight. This man was at the peak of his Hollywood career. He was a multi-millionaire as well. He had anything and everything he needed. And why did he die? And how did he kill himself? From a drug overdose. Or for example, a singer by the name of Whitney Houston, also a drug overdose. And I can give you tens and tens of examples of people that struggled and achieved their goals and still killed themselves. So, why am I saying this? And why do these people do what they're doing? Clearly because they're trying to run away from reality. Simply, when this person comes and is more hungry for money, and this person is hungry for something, hence he kills himself, or this person is hungry for money, popularity, so he tries as much as he can to get popularity. And when he can't get popularity, he kills himself either he kills himself, or he kills himself trying to become popular. One of the two. Clearly the reason is because they do not understand that they're trying to run away from reality. They realize that there's something missing. A pulse which is keeping them together. A pulse which is keeping them intact. So they do things like drinking. They do things like overdosing on drugs and whatnot. Just for the mere fact of running away from reality, that I'm not good enough, I don't have enough money, I don't have enough popularity, and whatnot. To understand the reasons which lead to depression, we have to understand the nature of the human being first. The human being, whatever skin tone he is, whatever culture he comes from, whatever religion he was born into, and whatever era he was part of, whether it was 1,000 years ago, 500 years ago, today, or 500 years to come. From the beginning of birth, he seeks to achieve perfection and benefit and runs away from harm. Last night we gave an example of a baby, if you guys remember, that the baby is always seeking and thriving, and his energy is the energy of positive change, correct? Let's bring this example again tonight and analyze this example a bit deeper, okay? A baby from the age of 3 months old sees everyone around him is talking. He tries to talk. Eventually he begins to talk. He sees them running and walking, he begins to walk. Because he finds that from the age he's at, he looks at the older person running, he thinks that's perfection. The older person talking, he thinks that's perfection. The older person walking, he thinks it's perfection. So, he tries to walk, he tries to run, he tries to talk and whatnot. As time passes also, he realized, it's not enough. I need to study now. So he begins to study university, study school. He finishes school, he studies university. And he still realizes, there's still something missing. So he finishes university. And then he gets a job. It's still, there's something more, there's something missing. I need more money, I need something, there's something missing. So he begins looking from job to job, finally finds a job that pays stable. So now he's comfortable. When it comes to money, he's comfortable. But is it enough? No. He then realizes money isn't enough. So he looks into politics and popularity. I swear, it sounds like I'm talking about Donald Trump. Then he realizes that it's not enough. Money is not enough. Education isn't enough. Then he realizes that maybe I should begin wars and begin fights to express my power, because education and money wasn't enough. So I have to begin wars and I have to begin fights. And even if we were to see this person were to have wars and have fights and conquer the world and have control of the whole world, this person's still going to look for something. He'll probably look at the skies, he'll look at the clouds and say, أنا ربكم الأعلى. Like Fir'aun, for example, Pharaoh. Pharaoh had everything, had the money, had essentially controlled most of the earth. So he came to the extent where he'd be like, okay,
not only am I rich and I have this and I have that, I am your Lord. He wants to become the Lord. أَنَا رَبُّكُمُ الْأَعْلَى. So if you were to give a human being, take away religion, take away Islam, take away the innate nature of the human being, just put the human being and say, okay, there's no guidelines, there's no rules for you. Nothing's holding you back. You can do whatever you want. The only thing this human being would want to do is absolutely reach the highest level of perfection he could reach. When it comes to power, when it comes to money, when it comes to education, when it comes to anything. That's the human being. So after this guy has searched and searched and searched and made the money and done all this other stuff and, you know, politically been up there, he still feels like there's something missing. What is it? Comfort. He wants comfort. He wants eternal comfort. He wants rest. So what does he do? He commits suicide. Thinking that, oh, when I commit suicide, I'm going to reach those levels of comfort. You know, I'll go down to the earth and khalas, sit down. Nothing happened. I'm comfortable like that. The whole journey I just spoke about now can be summarized into four things. Four things. Focus with me, brothers and sisters. Man seeking, when a human being is seeking infinite love, infinite knowledge, infinite power, and infinite life. The whole journey I just expressed right now is into these four lines. Infinite power, infinite love, infinite knowledge, and infinite life. Unfortunately for most of us, we search and search and search and search with this desire for infinity. But how do we search? We search through a limited scope. Muhammad Dhain is limited. I can't be over there and here at the exact same time. I can't be in three places at the same time. Neither can I fly. Neither can I know what you're thinking. I'm very limited. As we are, we're all limited. So when we come and look for infinity, when we come and look for perfection, it's basically like saying, I want to fill the whole ocean's water, all of the ocean, all of the water in the ocean, I want to fill it in a little water bottle. That's essentially what we're saying. I want to build a house with one piece of wood, one brick, and a bag of cement. But I want to build a whole house. That's how we seek the infinite love and infinite knowledge and infinite power and infinite life. Ask yourself, how do you feel when you feel depressed? What is the cause of depression? The cause of depression, simply, and I'll explain, the cause of depression is our wrong diagnosis of perfection. We diagnosed X as perfection, it turned out to be otherwise, we became depressed. Examples? Okay. You find a girl that is searching for infinite love. So if she falls in love with Yusuf, for example. And then she stays with Yusuf until Yusuf, for example, something happens, a fallout happens, and they break up. And this woman is absolutely shattered. And also may cause depression. And brothers, vice versa as well. A man comes searching for infinite love and finds it in, I don't know any girl's name here, so Samira, you know? Finds the infinite love in Samira. And then she feels like, oh no, he's not the right person. So she breaks up with him and he gets depressed. The reason he got depressed is because he thought infinite love is my love to Samira or her love to Yusuf. That's the reason. Brothers, on this point, inshallah, in the following nights we'll speak about it more. But the concept of love, unfortunately, nowadays, we've misunderstood it completely. we think that, oh, as long as I get to know a girl for a couple of days on Facebook or on WhatsApp, you know, send a few roses and some smiley faces, we fall in love. No, honestly, you know. And then subhanAllah, they speak for 2 or 3 weeks, no one knows him as much as I do. You know, I know all his secrets. I know all her secrets. She tells me everything about her. He tells me everything about him. Brothers, love, brothers and sisters, love is not something small. When Imam Ali alayhi salam comes and says in Munajat al-Sha'baniya, he says, Ya Allah, وَلَوْ أَدْخَلْتَنِ النَّارِ لَأَعْلَمْتُ أَهْلَهَا إِنِّي أُحِبُّكَ. If you were to put me in hellfire, Ya Allah, look what Imam alayhi salam is saying. If you were to put me in hellfire, I would tell the people in hell that I love you. That's love. That's love. He didn't say, لَأَعْلَمْتُ أَهْلَهَا إِنِّي أَعْبُدُكَ. He's not saying, I will tell the people in hell that I obey you, that I believe in you, or that I... No, no. I love you. So when you want to come and say the word love, connect the word love to your feelings and connect your feelings to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Connect the rope of love to the infinite. Inshallah, we'll speak about this soon. And it's an extremely important topic. It's something to be thinking about day in, day out. Because love is the connection between the creator and the created. Love. When I love someone, I respect them. When I love someone, I'm honest to them. When I love someone, I don't betray them. So when I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I respect Allah. And when I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I don't lie to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when I love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, really, truly love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when He tells me, Muhammad Dhainii, pray on time, Muhammad Dhainii, don't lie, Muhammad Dhainii, don't talk behind your brother's back, I won't. That's love. Continuing. We search for infinite love in a very limited scope. The man that's looking for infinite power, okay, this is very relative as well. When you find that a man reaches the age of 16 and 17, alhamdulillah, in our society as well, it's very, very common, reaches the age of 16, 17, 18, and gets into bodybuilding. He wants to get into gym. And I'm not saying gym's a bad thing. I'm just saying, don't think gym is power. Don't think gym is ultimate power. So he gets into the gym, and he buys this protein shake, and, you know, pre-workout and post-workout, and starts to exercise and starts to eat and whatnot, becomes big, becomes strong. The more muscles he sees, the more muscles he wants. Because he feels, my power, my physical power, what I want is infinite. That's why you see these bodybuilders, the bigger they get, the bigger they want to get. They look like balloons and they still want to get bigger. Okay? They want to get bigger because they want infinite power. Through infinite steroids as well. They take steroids because they think that is a pathway to power. Power, whether it's physical, whether it's political, a person that wants to take over the world. For example, the president of North Korea. This guy has put the people of North Korea in a box where they actually have absolutely no idea what's happening outside North Korea. They have 8 channels, I remember, 7 or 8 channels to watch from, no other channels. They don't know anything that's happening outside. They actually have a comedy show in North Korea, a comedy show of what happens in America. Like just normal day-to-day things that happen in America. It's a comedy show for them. He has this power over his people. He just wants to play with them like, you know, a baby plays with its toys. That's power. He wants power. He wants infinite power. Then a girl, sorry girls, wallah, forgive me. But then you find a girl that's looking for infinite beauty, okay? A girl that's looking for infinite beauty, so she becomes this makeup, you know, she loves putting makeup, tons of makeup. Inshallah, in the discussion tonight, we'll talk about makeup and whatnot. But she puts a lot of makeup on, and she still feels like, oh, you know, I hear this a lot, subhanAllah, I hear this a lot. Wallah, I'm not confident without makeup. It gives me confidence. you know. It makes me feel like, you know, people can look at me and birtah nafsiya and whatnot. So after she puts this makeup, she feels like, and obviously, brothers and sisters, when I'm giving these examples, I'm not saying every single person is like this. No. I'm saying there's some cases you find, alhamdulillah, some cases. In the cases of the mu'minin, you won't find anything of what I'm saying. In the cases of the mu'minin. When someone comes and tells you, I'm depressed, question him through these, or question her through these things I'm talking about. Question her. So, she searches for infinite beauty through makeup, and then eventually through plastic surgery, extensive plastic surgery, plastic surgery again, which will never finish. And then she just, by the way, she used to look like a human being, and now Allah Alam what she looks like. Okay? Because she's looking for infinite beauty. Tayyib. Then a person who is looking for infinite knowledge, a person who's studied high school, probably got the highest mark in his classes, finishes high school, goes to university, gets his first degree, gets his second degree, gets his third degree, gets his fourth degree, jumps on his fifth degree and fails one exam. One exam. And then he feels like he's a failure in life. Feels like he's an absolute failure. Khayyima, you just passed 4 degrees or 5 degrees. No. He wants infinite knowledge. Failing one exam is a barrier between him and infinite knowledge. He doesn't want to be a failure. He wants infinity. Wallah, examples are many, I can keep going on. But in conclusion, just to conclude these points, when you look for the reasons as to why you're depressed or why you're feeling in a specific way, don't search on the outside. Don't look at how much money, you know, X has and how much money I have. How many degrees she has and how many degrees I have. Connect yourself with yourself. Connect your heart with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the infinite, is the meaning, the concept of infinity. He is infinite love and He is infinite mercy and He is infinite knowledge and He is infinite life and He is infinite power. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the infinite. So when you connect yourself with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and understand yourself, search for your faults within you. So I know now that infinity is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Infinity, when it comes to love or power or beauty or whatever you want, infinity is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I'm feeling shway depressed. That's how I'm feeling right now. Diagnose yourself. Understand, Tayyib Muhammad, why am I depressed today? Okay, what am I doing? Why is there something that I wanted? And what stood in my way of getting what I wanted? Am I searching for something that I can't behold? Diagnose yourself. Then you go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with this, and He'll give you the solution. Tell me, Ya Allah, Ya Muta'ali al-Makam, Ya Allah. Ya Allah, You are the strong one, and You are the infinite. Anta al-Qadir, Anta al-Qahir, Anta al-Qawi. All these sifat, all these characteristics that I'm trying to grasp with my limited self, that's You. It's not me. So Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, please help me. Okay, I don't want infinite knowledge, but I just want some knowledge, Ya Allah. You have infinite knowledge. Give me some. Ya Allah, I don't have power. You're the one that has infinite power. Give me some. Understand that depression is caused from within yourself. Depression is a psychological thing. Psychologists come and tell you that if you were to understand in reality what depression is and understand how to actually fight depression, if you were to understand how to fight depression, no one would stand in your way. But the problem is we don't know how to diagnose why we're depressed. Wallah ta'bani nafsiti. Lash, wallah manni arif lash ta'bani nafsiti. Wallah, I don't know why. How many times do you hear that? Wallah, I don't know why. I don't know why. No, okay, it happens to every single one of us. But search and think, why? Why? Why am I tired? Why am I spiritually tired? Why am I physically tired? If Imam Hussein alayhi salam was looking for dunya, Imam Hussein alayhi salam, surely. Surely Imam Hussein alayhi salam would have been the most depressed one in the world. If this man was looking for dunya, and he's standing there on the plains of Karbala, and he sees his brothers, he sees his sons, and he sees his sisters about to be taken captive, what is this? Where's the beauty in that? When I'm talking on a dunya perspective, on a limited scope, where's the beauty in that? Absolutely no beauty. All I see is blood and death. Where's the beauty in that? If Imam Ali alayhi salam was looking for dunya, then being struck in sujood wouldn't be a reason to be saying, Fustu wa Rabb al-Kaaba. I am victorious by the Kaaba's Lord. If Sayyidah Zahra alayhi salam was looking for dunya as well, being broken between the door and the wall, that would be a failure. She's failed in dunya. Whereas you find that Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he answers it. He answers all the questions that we're asking him. All the questions that we've posed, he answers them in one line. When he puts his cheeks on the earth and everyone around him is dead, his women are taken captive, what is he doing? He's glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imagine that. Imagine, put yourself in that position where you're looking at Abu Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam. Just trying to imagine the scenario, the picture in front of me. I have Ali al-Akbar on the floor, Abu Fadl Abbas alayhi salam on the floor, Abu Fadl's hands on the floor. Then I have the woman screaming behind me. Al-Qasim, 14, 15 year old child also on the floor, dead, blood everywhere. And then Imam Hussein alayhi salam puts his cheek on the ground and he says, Ya muta'alil makan, Ya shadeed al-muhal, Ya azeem al-jabarut. Glorifying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why, Ya Aba Abdullah, and where did he get his power? He comes and answers us where? In Dua Arafah. He teaches us, brothers and sisters, the essence of connecting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Ilahi, كيف أخيب وأنت أملي. Ilahi, my Lord, how will I lose faith? How will I be defeated? How will I surrender? How will I get depressed? And you're my hope, God. You're the rope that I hold on to, Ya Allah. In this way, even if you've lost everything you love, even if you've lost everyone you love, even if you see your son's beheaded on the floor in front of you, even if you saw your cousins on the floor in front of you, and even if you saw your brother severed from head to toe, you'd say, Ma ra'aytu illa jameela. Now, brothers and sisters, honestly, I want you to close your eyes and picture this scenario. After a holy Imam, Abu Abdullah Hussein alayhi salam, bids farewell to his grandfather Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and to his mother Fatima, he then moves on to bid farewell to another Fatima, his daughter. His young teenage daughter, brothers and sisters, who was extremely sick at the time, he goes to her and says, My daughter, it's time. Ya Fatima, it's time. It's time to bid farewell to your family, Ya Fatima. It's time to kiss the neck of your brother, Abdullah al-Radi' for the last time, Ya Fatima. Ya Fatima, hug your uncle Abbas, Ya Fatima. Because after this you will not be able to hug your uncle Abbas. Fatima, Fatima, kiss your auntie Zainab whilst you still notice her, Ya Fatima. Because when she comes back from Karbala, you will not recognize your auntie Zainab, Ya Fatima. My daughter, come and hug me. Assalamu alaikum, Ya Abdullah. My daughter, come and hug me and pray that you don't see my severed body like your family will see on the 10th day of Ashura. Fatima, kiss my head while it's still attached to my body. Because Fatima, soon your sister Ruqayya will kiss my head when it's detached from my body. Fatima, what is going to happen is going to be crucial. Be patient, my daughter, Ya Fatima. Ma'adharufkum lo kuntum bayna nisaikum. A'ishu fi dhulli al-asa wa udhamu ahna alayha. ثم قبل ثغرها والدمع فاض كما يفيض ركام. الله ما حال الحسين بمشهد فيه الحسين فؤاده أقسام. شدقر للعلي لفاطمة تعود يا أبتي لدارك سالمة. تعود يا أبتي لدارك سالمة. هيهات يرجع للحسين سلام. احفظ هذه الأبيات. ألا لا تزال الدار، ألا لا تزال الدار إلا بأهلها. على الدار من بعد الحسين سلام. أبا عبد الله، خذني معكم يا أبتي. قال لها بني أنت عليلة لا طاقة لك على السفر. Father, take me with you, please, Ya Aba Abdullah. He tells her, my daughter, you are too sick to be able to travel. قالت يا أبا خذني معكم لا طاقة لي على فراقكم. Father, I can't handle to be alone without you. خذوني 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 وياكم اسرج الخيل وحطوا افراشكم لا هود الليل. خذوني معاكم يا ابا عبد الله لو خادمة بالطريق. Abu Abdullah, take me with you. I'll be a servant on your way. I'll be at service. أفرش الفراش
أسكب الماء. Father, I will prepare the babies to sleep. I will pour you some water. قال لها يا بني لا طاقة لك على السفر. حينها ودعها الحسين. ودعها النساء. ودعها الأطفال. They all bid their farewell to Fatima. مشوا عني الأحبهم انعصر قلبي بضربهم أموتا من بعدهم يروح شلون بيا على الطول سفرهم طفت عيني بصورهم دعيت الله ليردهم ويردون إلي مشوا عني الأحبهم نعصر قلبي بضربهم أموتا من بعدهم يروح شلون بي على الطول سفرهم طفت عيني بصورهم دعيت الله ليردهم ويردون إلي ترد روحي إذا قالوا ألج كلهم يردون على جروحي شماتنا أول كلهم يمرون ترد روحي إذا قالوا هلج كلهم يردون على جروحي شمات لو أول كلهم يعرفون راحوا مني وظلت ذكرى ودمعة وسط البيت بواج مفارق عيوني من حالي ولا مليت من حالي ولا مليت يا أبا عبد الله السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت وبقي الليل والنهار أزور سيدي ومولاي ومعتمدي ورجائي أبا عبد الله الحسين السلام عليك يا وارث آدم صفوة الله السلام عليك يا وارث روح النبي الله السلام عليك يا وارث إبراهيم خليل الله السلام عليك يا وارث موسى كليم الله السلام عليك يا وارث عيسى روح الله السلام عليك يا وارث محمد حبيب الله السلام عليك يا وارث أمير المؤمنين عليه السلام السلام عليك يا ابن محمد المصطفى السلام عليك يا ابن علي المرتضى السلام عليك يا ابن فاطمة الزهراء السلام عليك يا ابن خديجة الكبرى السلام عليك يا ثار الله وابن ثار والوتر الموتور أشهد أنك قد أقمت الصلاة وآتيت الزكاة وأمرت بالمعروف ونهيت عن المنكر وأطعت الله ورسوله حتى أتاك اليقين فلعن الله أمة قتلتك ولعن الله أمة ظلمتك ولعن الله أمة سمعت بذلك فرضيت به يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله أشهد أنك كنت نورا في الأصلاب الشامخة والأرحام المطهرة لم تنجزك الجاهلية بأنجاسها ولم تلبسك من مدلهمات ثيابها وأشهد أنك من دعائم الدين وأركان المؤمنين وأشهد أنك الإمام البر التقي الرضي الزكي الهادي المهدي وأشهد أن الأمة من ولدك كلمة التقوى وأعلام الهدى والعروة الوثقى والحجة على أهل الدنيا وأشهد الله وملائكته وأنبياءه ورسله إني بكم مؤمن وبإيامكم موقن بشرائع ديني وخواتيم عملي وقلبي لقلبكم سلم وأمري لأمركم متبع صلوات الله عليكم وعلى أرواحكم وعلى أجسادكم وعلى أجسامكم وعلى شاهدكم وعلى غائبكم وعلى ظاهركم وعلى باطنكم بأبي أنت وأمي يا ابن رسول الله بأبي أنت وأمي يا أبا عبد الله لقد عظمت الرزية لقد عظمت الرزية وجلت المصيبة بك علينا وعلى جميع أهل السماوات والأرض فلعن الله أمة أسرجت وألجمت وتهيأت لقتالك يا مولاي يا أبا عبد الله أسدت حرمك وأتيت بقلبي إلى مشهدك أسأل الله بالشأن الذي لك عنده وبالمحل الذي لك لدي أن يصلي على محمد وآل محمد وأن يجعلني معكم في الدنيا والآخرة آمين رب العالمين برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين وصل اللهم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين.